We all know what shame feels like. I don't care how good a person you feel like you are, we know what it's like to fail, and we know what it's like to feel that dark feeling of shame. Every one of us. When I first got married to Bethany, we had a trailer that we lived in. It was a little love bungalow that we had, and we didn't have much money, and at the time, I don't know if this is still the case, somebody's always looking to give away a waterbed, okay? So we had a free king-size waterbed in our trailer. It was real nice, you know? And we spent some, our first couple weeks probably, we came off the honeymoon, spent a few nights there, and as we slept, you know, in the same bed for the first time, first couple of weeks, one night I woke up, and the bed was wet. And I was like, oh no, this thing's got a hole in it. It's got a leak in it. And then this terrifying feeling came over me. And I felt myself, and I was also wet. And then I kind of felt my new bride, and she was not wet. And I was like, oh no. No, 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 no. So I felt the sheets with my hand, and then I slowly brought my hand up to my nose, and I'm like, I had peed on my wife. It's just a horrible feeling of shame came over me. And so, you know, we were newlyweds, and I had to wake her up and tell her that I had just wet the bed. And not just a little bit, like everywhere. Looking back, I wish I would have gotten a pocket knife and just popped a hole in the bed. That would have been the smart thing to do, right? But that's not what I did. I kind of reached over and I kind of shook her awake. Well, now we're newlyweds, so what do you think she thinks I'm waking her up for, right? She's like, oh, hi. And I'm like, I peed on you. Wake her up in the middle of the night. True story. So that actually happened. And there in the dark, right before I told her, there was this moment of shame, right? That moment where, like, can I hide this? Is it possible for me to cover this up? I don't want to feel this. I wish this never happened. We got that moment of shame. I want you to know I've done some real things that cause shame. Nothing that I really care to share with you today. But I want you to know I've done a lot worse things than that. And I have felt that cold, empty, hollow, lonely feeling of regret and shame. And not only that, but to also know that that monster's still alive, that person inside of me that has shame because of that, I don't even know that I can trust that that's not going to happen again. I know what shame feels like. And in this series, what we want to do is we want you to know that God wants to remove your shame. God wants you to live without shame. Most people think going to church is all about feeling the shame, right? That's why you go to church, to like feel bad about yourself and go home. That's not at all what this is about. God wants you to have your shame completely removed. The biggest and most important question that we have to ask during this series, and you have to ask every day for the rest of your life, is, does God want me to feel this shame? Let's start there. Does God want me to feel the shame? Because we all feel it. And the question is, does God want me to feel it? Because if God doesn't want me to feel it, then I don't need to worry about it. But if God does want me to feel the shame, if God gave me the shame for a reason, then I need to figure out what that is, right? So the question I want you to ask throughout this series and every day of your life is the shame I'm feeling something God wants me to feel or not? And here's why that's important. Because people put shame on us like crazy. People try to motivate us. People try to manipulate us. People try to get us to get out of their way. People try to feel better about themselves by shaming us. There's a lot of shame that's being passed around in the world, and I want you to know that doesn't matter. What matters is whether or not God wants you to feel the shame. I'll give you a couple examples. One of the times that I feel shame that I'm absolutely confident I don't need to feel shame about is I take my little kids to school, my 11 and my 9-year-old, and I drop them off at the front door at the school. Now, we get this memo every year when the weather gets cold from teachers, and I gotta know, I love you teachers, you're fantastic, but I hate this memo. It's this email that we get and says, just remember, it's cold outside, so send your kids to school with a coat on. I hate that. Let me tell you why I hate it. I know the motivation is probably for parents that are too selfish to even buy their kids a coat, right? I know that's probably it, but what it feels like is you're telling me the reason my kids ought to wear a coat is because I need to make them wear a coat, and I live by a different set of rules than that, okay? I walk a different path, okay? I want my kids to wear a coat for one reason. Not because the teachers say they should, not because I tell them they should. The reason children should wear a coat is only one reason. And do you know why that is? Because they're cold. They're cold. That's why you wear a coat. And people are like, well, they'll catch a cold. Oh my God. That is like science from the 50s. Like, you don't get a cold from getting cold. That's not a real thing, right? And yet people are just like, you got to have your kids wear a coat. You got to have a kid. No, I believe in what the Bible says. The Bible says you reap what you sow. And my kids, I'll sometimes drop them off, and all they got on is a jacket, and they jump out of the car. And the teacher then, who's parking the cars, looks over at me and gives me one of these. Right? Just like, you stupid person, right? And I put them on, and I got to tell you, as much shame as being sent my way in that moment, I don't feel it at all. Because my kids are going to wear a coat for one reason, because they get cold, right? So I don't take that shame. Another example in here. Ladies, I've been thinking about you a lot this week. You are under a lot of pressure, and you feel shamed because of the body that you have or the body you don't have, right? And it doesn't really matter what you have. Somebody's disappointed with it, or somebody wants to make you feel bad about it, or it's the clothes that you have, or the hair that you do, or the nails that you have done, and you are under constant pressure to not feel this shame. And so people want to make you feel this shame. But the question is, does God want you to feel that shame? Does God want you to feel shame about the way you look, whether you got a badonkadonk or don't have a badonkadonk, right? Do you think God wants you to feel shame about it? I mean, there's some ladies out there that are thinking about having butt implants, right? Like putting things in your butt because you feel shame about your flat butt. I mean, just let me... Wah! Shame's a powerful motivating tool, and I want to just free you of that. All you got to ask the question is not what other people think, but does God want you to feel shame? Does God want you to feel shame about that? And here's what I can tell you. No. And I can tell you why I know that. 1 Peter chapter 3 says this. Your beauty, it says, should not come from outward adornment, shouldn't come from braided hair, shouldn't come from gold jewelry, shouldn't come to whether your tan is on point, it shouldn't come from whether your clothes are perfect, it shouldn't come to whether or not you have a jacket that you wear with only one outfit. There's starving children in the world, and you feel the need to have a jacket that you only wear with one outfit that maybe you only wear like once a month or something like that. It shouldn't come from this outward appearance. It shouldn't come from whether you're tall or short or fat or voluptuous or a beanpole, right? It shouldn't come from that. But it says, 1 Peter chapter 3, it didn't say all that. 1 Peter chapter 3, it says, but your beauty should come from, listen, this is so important for you, it should come from an inner beauty, a gentle and quiet spirit, listen, doesn't end there, which is of great worth in God's sight, which is of great worth in God's sight. And you're trying to impress some sniveling punk, some 30-year-old dude that's trying to land you, some person that made you feel like you got to be something, and God's going, no, you don't need to feel that way. The question is, does God want you to feel the shame? And then you got to process, like, if God doesn't want me to feel ashamed, then by faith, I don't need to feel shame about that. I don't need to feel shame about that. Here's what Psalm 34:5 says. We all need to live by this. Those who look to Him, those who look to God, not to men, not to people, those who look to God are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. See, God wants to remove the shame in your life. And if that shame is coming from people, it's coming from men, coming from somebody else, some outward source, God wants you to not feel that at all. Now, I would love to end the entire series right there and walk away and say, hey, never feel shame again. All of us are great. But that's not real. The truth is that shame has a function. It has a purpose. There is a reason why we experience shame. And it's a lot like the reason we experience hunger. It's the reason why we feel the drive to sleep. This drive inside of us, the shame that we feel, is sometimes misconstrued, but this shame has a point, and God gave it to us for a reason, because there are things in this world that we need to feel shame about. Not for the rest of our lives, but God wants to have us feel shame, and there is a purpose for that. So this shame that you have in your life is really God wrestling inside of you. And there's two things that we do with that. Either one, we run from God, or two, we run to God. There's only two choices. We run from God or we run to God. Here, let me give you two definitions of shameless, okay? The first definition of shameless looks like this. Not embarrassed or ashamed. Like, that's how most people use shameless. Like, I've just decided that I'm not going to be embarrassed because I got this guilt and I got this shame and I don't want to do that anymore. So you know what? I've decided that I'm okay, you're okay, I'm okay. I'm just going to live however I want to live and I will not feel shame anymore. The problem with that is it doesn't work. We run from shame and maybe for the moment we're like, okay, I haven't done anything wrong. I'm not going to feel bad about that at all. But what happens is you end up making more mistakes, and what happens is it's going to come back on you. And you're going to feel, at a later point in your life, you're going to feel more shame than you've ever felt in your life. You can't live shameless. There's a movie on, or there's a show on HBO or somewhere. I don't know what, Showtime. It looks like this, Shameless. Anybody know this? We thought this might be one of the first things that pops into your head. That's what this is. This is a show about people who are vulgar and just sort of out there and just doing it. And they're like, I'm not going to make anybody feel bad about anything. I'm just going to do me. It doesn't work. I promise you, if that's been your strategy, and maybe that's what's kept you out of church, maybe that's kept you away from God, you are running away from God saying, I'm not going to feel any shame. God just makes me feel shame when I get close to God, so I'm done with it. I'm just going to be shameless. It doesn't work. It's kind of like saying this. It's kind of like saying, hey, it's tax time, and you guys don't have to pay taxes, and I don't have to pay taxes. Isn't that fantastic? None of us have to pay taxes. We don't have to get our taxes done. We don't have to dig up receipts. We can just walk out of here and not do taxes. Doesn't that sound great? And you might walk out of here, and you'll be like, man, that's amazing. Pastor said I didn't have to pay taxes. Might feel good, but what's the problem? It's not true. It's just not true. And you're going to find yourself in a world of hurt if you don't pay your taxes, right? God doesn't want us to be shameless because it's not possible to just run from God. The second definition of what we're using for this series is to be shameless. Looks like this. Just having your shame removed, because that's what God wants to do. God wants to get down deep in your heart and your life, and he wants to remove your shame. He doesn't want you to wallow in it. He doesn't want to have to deal with it for the rest of your life. He wants you to, for a purpose, he wants you to experience it, and then he wants to remove it. And so today, what we have to do is we have to kind of start with some open heart surgery. We're going to dig a little deep today. We're going to go into that feeling of shame that maybe you have. And maybe that shame comes from a long time ago. Maybe it's the shame you're living in right here and right now. It's regret, it's remorse, it's guilt, whatever it is. We're going to dig into that shame and we're going to show you what God wants to do with that. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, Paul writes his second letter to the church in Corinth. So he's already written the first letter. That's 1 Corinthians. I know. The Bible's so hard to understand. But the first letter is 1 Corinthians. And in 1 Corinthians, Paul addresses them and says, hey, you guys have some problems. And here's what your problem looks like. You guys don't have any standards for what it means to live for God. 1 Corinthians 5, we find out that somebody in the Corinth church was actually sleeping with their dad's wife. Not the mom, but their dad's new wife. They were sleeping with it, and the church was bragging about it. They were like, man, we got all kinds of sinners. We got people who are homosexual over here and people that are having sex before marriage over here, and we even got a guy who's sleeping with his dad's wife. Isn't that great? They were proud of it. And Paul goes, that is not great. And so he writes to them 1 Corinthians chapter 5, and he says some really difficult things to the church and says, no, you're not doing what God wants you to do. You need to repent of that. Now, we're not quite sure what happened between 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, but in 2 Corinthians, Paul addresses the first letter that he sent to them because they were filled with remorse about it. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 starts like this, verse 8. He said, even if I caused you sorrow by my letter, I do not regret it. So he starts off and he says, man, I know my first letter, it was difficult for you to hear and it was painful, but I don't regret it. We need to understand that. It's okay to say things that causes people regret. And some of you, especially if your parents out there, maybe your grandparents, you need to know. You need to lovingly express things that are going to cause regret in people's life. And they're going to be put in a place where it causes them sorrow, but that's okay. That's okay. Sometimes, in order to love people, you need to tell them things that cause them sorrow. And Paul says, I don't regret it. Though I did regret it. This is what he says. Though I did regret it, so it's kind of like after I scold one of the children and send them to their room crying, I turn to my wife and I'm like, was I too hard on them? Right? That's what Paul's like, man, he sent this letter and man, they cried about it. And he says, well, you know, for the moment, I might have regretted it. I see that my letter hurt you, but only for a little while. Yet now I'm happy. Not because you were made sorry, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. Let me say that again. Your sorrow led you to repentance. That's the purpose of shame. Shame is intended to lead you to repentance. Not to make you feel bad about who you are for the rest of your life, but to lead you to a decision. Let's talk about that word repentance for just a minute. I know growing up, what I thought of as repentance, when somebody would say repent, I thought that it basically meant going somewhere, folding my hands, and saying, God, I'm sorry. That's what I thought repentance was. I thought it was a simple prayer where I go, God, I'm sorry. Some of you, maybe you grew up Catholic. You think that repentance is confessing to a priest, or maybe it's a penance in your head, is saying a Hail Mary or a certain prayer or something like that. When we think of repentance, you might think of a bunch of different religious practices. That's not what it is. Repentance is actually a very simple concept. Let me describe it in two ways. The first way is this. The Greek word actually means U-turn. So when I first moved to Michigan, one of the new things for me that I had never experienced before was going right to go left. Still not used to it. I'll still just click on my blinker in the middle of an intersection sometime. People will honk at me and I'll be like, shut up, I'm from Nebraska. Anyway. No, to go right, to go left, and then you do the turnabout thing. That turnabout thing right there, that's repentance. That's what repentance means. That moment where you're heading in this direction, but you're actually trying to go that direction. When you repent, you're turning around. You're making a U-turn. You're heading in the other direction. If it was the Grant translation of the Bible, here's what repentance simply means. Stop it. Right? Stop it. That's all he's trying to say here, is the sorrow and the shame that you feel is God's way of leading to you to a place where you will... Oh, that's where you're supposed to... Thank you. Okay. God's shame and the first service got that. Okay, I just want to... God's shame and his sorrow is a place where you will stop it. And I can tell you, until you get to that place of repentance, you're going to be dragging shame around with you your whole life. You are going to be saddled with shame, and it is going to drive you and hang on to your heart, and you're going to feel unworthy. But if you come to a place where you make the U-turn, where you stop it, where you decide to live God's way and not your way, that doesn't mean you're going to be perfect, but you're going to do what God wants you to do, then and only then can God remove your shame. He continues on. He says, for you became sorrowful, you were filled with shame, listen to this, as God intended, and so were not harmed in any way by us. In other words, through this letter, God was saying, man, I want you to feel this sorrow, I want you to feel this shame, but only to lead you to a place where you will change. Now, here's the money verse. If you're going to take a picture of any slide, if you're going to post anything on Facebook, if you're going to memorize a scripture, if you're going to carry anything on with you this week, this is the verse, verse 10. It says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves, check it out, no regret. Godly sorrow, let me say that again, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. Let me tell you the difference between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. Ladies, you're out there and you're going to feel shame for the rest of your life about the way you look. That's worldly sorrow. And I can tell you, if you decide to be who the people in this world think you should be, and this is not just ladies, but just everybody, if you live by that kind of sorrow, you're going to feel like that for the rest of your life. And pretty soon, you're going to watch yourself become middle-aged, and you're going to have more problems. And you're going to get turn into an old lady eventually. And then the big payoff is, guess what happens? You die, and you're worried right before you die about what you're going to look like in the casket. I've done a lot of funerals, and I've talked to a lot of people before they die, and they were concerned about what their makeup was going to look like in the casket, right? That's worldly shame, and you're just the big payoff to that is one day you get to die. But godly sorrow leads you to repentance, it leads you to God's heart, it leads you close to Him to where you're, the only thing you're concerned about in this world is what God wants from you. And He leads you to that place. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. Verse 11. See what this godly sorrow has produced in you. So this church then got this letter from Paul and they're like, no, that is not us. We are going to redefine ourselves. We are not going to be that church that is just so consumed with the wrong side of God's grace that we're just going to allow everything. No, we're going to clean house. We're going to change business. We are going to be innocent in this matter. So he says, see what godly sorrow has produced in you, what earnestness, what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what alarm, what longing, what concern, what readiness to see justice done. At every point you have proved yourself to be innocent in this matter. So even though I wrote to you, it was neither on account of the one who did the wrong, nor on the account of the injured party, but rather that God... Before God, you could see for yourselves how devoted to us you are. And then he ends with just this one line. By all this, we are encouraged. By all this, we are encouraged. Even though this was difficult for you, it was painful for you, by all this, we are encouraged that you turned. You made the U-turn, you repented, you came back to the heart of God, you got rid of yourself, and you started to live your life for God. Sometimes in order to be without shame, to have God remove our shame, we have to go through some very difficult heart surgery. But when we get on the other side of that, that's where God takes it away. That's where God removes it, that's where He washes us. You know what happened after I wet the bed? Everybody woke back up. After that happened, my wife, I woke her up, and she just had a moment of disbelief, right, there in the darkness, and she said, go take a shower. And I was like, okay, and I went and jumped in the shower, and when I came out, she had stripped the beds down, and she had washed it, and we made the bed, and we got back in, and then she never mentioned it again. I told it at every party I've ever been at. I think it's amazing, but she never brought it up. She never made me feel, but she just washed it and we moved on. God wants to remove the sin in your life. He wants to remove the stain that you have. He wants to make you clean and new, and then He wants to never mention it again. God doesn't rub people's noses in stuff. That's what we think God is. But that's not who God is. I remember when my mom trained our Labrador, I remember that dog would pee in the house when it was a puppy, and my mom would grab that thing by the back of the neck, and she would rub it in the pee, and she would say, bad dog, right? That's who we think God is. God's rubbing our nose in it. That's what Bethany could have done. We think that's who God is. That's not who God is. God doesn't want to rub your nose in the sin. He doesn't want you to have that haunt, that shame haunt you, that guilt to follow you around the rest of life. He wants to wash you and make you new. He just needs you to want it. He just needs you to want it. And this is something you have to believe by faith. See, today you might be in here and you might be in the right in the middle of your shame. You know where your heart's at and you are convicted today and it's overwhelming to the point where you want to run from God. You want to not come back to church. You're like, it'll be a long time before you see me in a building like this because I want to run from God. But God's saying, no, just drop it. Just repent of it. Just turn from it. And if you do that, I can promise you walk out of here today without shame. See, here's the beauty. You don't have to do Hail Marys. You don't have to confess to a priest. You don't have to like do a tour of duty over in our children's ministry. You don't have to do that. You don't have to scrub our floors. You don't have to do anything like that. All you have to do is repent. Lay it down. Walk away. Say, God, I'm not going to run from this anymore. I'm not going to try to justify this anymore. I am going to live for you. And when you do that, God washes you and he makes you new. Maybe some of you out there, you've laid this down before. Maybe you made a decision to follow Christ a long time ago, but there's this haunting feeling of shame, remorse, regret, things that still follow you around and haunt you from the past. And you still feel like God just wants you to be under this incredible weight of shame, even though you've turned from it. You've repented from it. And what I want to tell you today is you're free. There's nothing left for you to do. If you've turned from it, you're free. All you have to do is believe God more than you believe yourself. Because what we do is we got this little voice in our head saying, we got to feel like dirt and we're not worthy and God doesn't want me and I can't follow him. But we got to believe God more than that voice inside of our head, because God has said to you, if you've turned from your sin, God has said, I have made you new. And you need to walk like somebody who has been made new, who has had their sins forgiven, who has had their filthy clothes replaced with God's bright white linens. You need to walk out of here today, not believing yourself, but believing God. And if you do, yeah, praise God. And if you do that, there is nothing in between you and God. Believe in what God has said more than what you say. Today, I'm going to pray a simple prayer that not one person in this room would walk out of here carrying the shame that they walked in here with. Let me pray for you. God, I pray, Lord, for those who came in guilty, covered in shame. God, I pray as they repent today, as they lay it before you, as they surrender it all, that they would feel that burden fall off of their back, that their heart would be free, and that the joy of repentance would be replaced in their heart. God, that they would experience you at this moment right now. God, for those who have been carrying around shame their entire life or for a long time that just don't need to carry that anymore, God, I pray that they would believe in you, have faith to believe in what you have said is absolutely true. God, I pray that you would replace our sin, our shame with joy. And I pray that in Christ's name. Amen.